I'm Rex. I work here. I'm also the like event manager, newly coined, here at Unnameable. This is like my and Hannah's inaugural event. Hannah works here as well and is a philosophy doctoral candidate and amazing. And we're like super, super excited to have Sarah Schulman here. We were both really big fans of her and her work. So Sarah Schulman is the author of 17 previous books, including the novels The Cosmopolitans, Rap Bohemia, and Empathy, and the nonfiction books The Gentrification of the Mind, Witness to a Lost Imagination, and Ties That Bind Familial Homophobia and Its Consequences. Her latest book is Conflict Is Not Abuse, Overstating Harm, Community Responsibility, and the Duty of Repair. Her many honors include a Guggenheim Fellowship in Playwriting, a Fulbright Fellowship in Judaic Studies, and the Kessler Award for Lifetime Contribution to LGBT Studies. She is a Distinguished Professor of the Humanities at the City University of New York, College of Staten Island. Please join me in welcoming Sarah Schulman.
Thanks. You look like a group of very nice people. Thank you, Hannah and Rex, for inviting me. I love the vibe here. I'm really happy to be here. So before I start, unfortunately, the election has proven my book to be very accurate. So let me just start by throwing out a big idea, and then I'll do the teacher thing and like lay it all out and build to it. But basically, I think one of the central ideas in the book is that there's this incredible similarity between entitled and supremacist behavior and traumatized, unrecovered behavior. That even though you would think that these are completely opposite experiences, there's a way that they mirror each other. Even though we know that supremacy in one place produces trauma in another place, and also that both can exist in the same body. But the way that they mirror each other is that the supremacist person often cannot tolerate opposition at all. They feel entitled to never be opposed or questioned and to never have to question themselves. And so when they are opposed or when someone asks them to be accountable or to be self-critical, they see that as a kind of abuse or attack or violation. And they'll often use abuse tropes. So the perfect example is Donald Trump, who multiple times a day describes himself as victimized. He's especially when other people tell the truth. He'll always say that he's being attacked, he's their victim, they're lying. For example, when he broke diplomatic protocol by calling Taiwan, and then his answer was, "She called me." You know, he's completely unable to be self-critical. On the other hand, traumatized people, especially people who are not in recovery, often also find it very hard to bear criticism or opposition. And also often have the same experience that when they're being asked to be self-critical or they're being opposed, they feel that they're under enormous attack, that they're being violated and being abused. But the reason is completely different. It's not like the supremacist person who just feels entitled to do whatever they want and never be questioned. It's that when we've gone through trauma, sometimes ourselves are so fragile and it's so hard to keep things together, that any kind of pressure on that system that we've developed to survive with feels like everything's gonna fall apart. And so very normative opposition can feel like an enormous, enormous attack. And I think that we see that in this election as well. When you look at white working class people who are clearly victimized by the class system, who have been unable to lay the blame of their experience on the people who've actually created it, which is the 1% who's globalized their jobs, because they have such identification through race with rich white people who white people are taught to identify with, that it's too emotionally challenging and too self-critical. You have to be too self-critical to put the blame where it really should lie. And so they're manipulated to exteriorize their anxieties and blame the only group that's less powerful than they are, which is immigrants. That to be accurate. Okay, so now I'll give you the real presentation. So I'm just going to start with a little paragraph from the methodology section. I ask you to read this book the way you would watch a play. Not to emerge saying, the play is right, but rather to observe that the play reveals human nuance, contradiction, limitation, joy, connection, and the tragedy of separation. This is not a book to be agreed with, an exhibition of evidence, nor a display of proof. It is instead designed for engaged and dynamic, interactive collective thinking, where some ideas will resonate, others will be rejected, and still others will provoke the readers to produce new knowledge themselves. Like authentic conscious relationships, truly progressive communities, responsible citizenship, and real friendship, and like the peacemaking that all these require, it asks you to be interactive. Okay? All right then. So I start with a little quote from James Baldwin. Not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it is faced. As I began this book during the summer of 2014, the human community witnessed systemic repetition of unjustified cruelty with exhaustion and frustration. We watched white police officers in Ferguson, Missouri and Staten Island, New York, murder two unarmed black men, Michael Brown and Eric Garner. We watched a rich and powerful professional football player, Ray Rice, beat his wife, Janae, unconscious in an elevator. We watched the Israeli government mass murder over 2,000 Palestinian civilians in Gaza. It quickly became apparent that the methods we have developed collectively to date to understand these kinds of actions in order to avoid them are not adequate. Now, as a novelist, in order to create characters that have integrity, I apply the principle that people do things for reasons, even if they are not aware of those reasons, or even if they cannot accept that their actions are motivated instead of neutral and objective. Using this principle to examine those events, I have to ask myself what the white police officers, the wealthy football player, and the militarized nation state think is happening that produces and justifies their brutal actions. As video and witness accounts attest, neither Michael Brown nor Eric Garner did anything that justified the way they were treated by the police. Eric Garner sold loose cigarettes and Michael Brown walked down the street. Both men tried to offer the police alternatives to cruelty. Eric Garner informed the police of the consequences of their actions on him when he told them 11 times while in an illegal chokehold, "I can't breathe." Michael Brown raised his hands in a sign of surrender and said, "Don't shoot." But something occurred within the minds, impulses, and group identities of the white police officers in that they construed the original non-event, compounded with these factual and peacemaking communications, as some kind of threat or attack. In other words, these policemen looked at nothing, the complete absence of threat, and there they saw threat gross enough to justify murder. Nothing happened, but these people with power saw abuse. We know from security camera footage taken in a casino lobby and elevator that Baltimore Ravens running back Ray Rice and his wife were having a quarrel. As much as we don't like quarrels with our partners and wish they wouldn't happen, disagreement with one's lover is a normative part of human experience. It is impossible to live without it ever taking place. Intimate disagreement is, as they say, life. Yet Ray Rice experienced normative regular conflict that exists in every relationship, family, and household in the world as so overwhelmingly unbearable and threatening that he hit his wife, knocking her unconscious and dragged her limp body by the ankles out of the elevator, leaving her lying inert in a hallway. He looked at normative everyday conflict and responded with extreme cruelty. He looked at the regular, even banal expression of difference, and saw threat. The Israeli government has kept the Palestinian Gaza Strip under siege since 2005. This has made daily life unbearable for its inhabitants. In the late spring of 2014, the government of Benjamin Netanyahu escalated pressure on the already suffering Palestinians, and some factions within Gaza responded with rockets that were of such poor quality they had only symbolic impact. The Israeli government re-reacted in turn to this response with over 50 days of aerial bombing and ground invasion, causing mass death and massive destruction of literal, cultural, and psychological infrastructure. The Gazans were reacting to a state of injustice that the Israelis had created. The Gazans were resisting. They were refusing to go along with unbearable and unjustifiable treatment. The Israelis experienced this resistance to ongoing unfair treatment as attack. Brown and Garner did absolutely nothing but be black. Janae Rice expressed normative conflict. Gazans resisted unbearable treatment. In all of these cases, the police, the husband, and the nation overstated harm. They took nothing, normative conflict and resistance, and misrepresented these reasonable stances of difference as abuse. From the most intimate relationship between two people, to the power of the police, to the crushing reality of occupation, these actors displayed distorted thinking in which justifiable behavior was understood as aggression. In this way, they overreacted at a level that produced tragedy, pain, and division. It is this moment of overreaction that I wish to examine in this book. My thesis is that at many levels of human interaction, there is the opportunity to conflate discomfort with threat, to mistake internal anxiety for exterior danger, and in turn to escalate rather than resolve. I will show how this dynamic, whether between two individuals, between groups of people, between governments and civilians, or between nations, is a fundamental opportunity for either tragedy or peace. Conscious awareness of these political and emotional mechanisms gives us all a chance to face ourselves, to achieve recognition and understanding in order to avoid escalation towards unnecessary pain. Do you guys want to come in? There's some chairs over there. However, it is not only the police, wealthy football players, or colonial occupiers who can feel abused in the absence of actual threat. It is not only the dominant who feel endangered when faced with normative conflict or when their own unjust actions are responded to with resistance. In fact, these distorted reactions occur in both the powerful and the weak, the supremacist and the traumatized, in society and in intimacy. In arenas in which real abuse could conceivably take place, there are those who feel persecuted and threatened even though they are not in danger, and they often lack help from those around them to differentiate between the possible and the actual. Bullies often conceptualize themselves as being under attack when they are the ones originating the pain. Everywhere we look, there's confusion between conflict and abuse. If a person cannot solve a conflict with a friend, how can they possibly contribute to larger efforts for peace? If we refuse to speak to a friend because we project our anxieties onto an email they wrote, how are we going to welcome refugees, immigrants, and the homeless into our communities? The values required for social repair are the same values required for personal repair, and so this discussion must begin in the most micro experience. Confusing being mortal with being threatened can occur in any realm. The fact that something could go wrong does not mean that we are in danger. It means that we are alive. So, on a freezing snowy day in 2014, I was invited to a workshop run by social worker Catherine Hodes. A native New Yorker in her 50s, Catherine is an experienced professional with over 20 years of development and leadership in what was once known as the battered women's movement, but is now called intimate relationship abuse advocacy, where she is now known as a service provider. Intimate abuse is a real crisis for New York.
The New York Times reported in November 2014 that the police received 284,000 intimate abuse calls a year, which is about 800 a day, and make 46,000 intimate abuse arrests every year. Hodes had boldly started to notice that clients were increasingly confused about what the word abuse actually means, that it was overused. The paradox is, of course, that many women are unable to recognize that they are being abused, or they cannot get acknowledgement of this reality from others. But at the very same time, Hodes also found that some women were applying the term abuse to situations that were really something else. Increasingly, she noticed that women who did not know how to resolve a problem sometimes described that feeling with the word abuse. So this session had been convened to address that trend directly with service providers. Now, Hodes' focus was to help social workers differentiate between abuse and conflict so that they could be effective and directed in helping clients in ways that would speak to their real experiences. While identifying abuse is essential to saving lives and providing services, differentiating conflict from abuse is also essential to meeting clients' real need to learn how to face and deal with obstacles and to develop truthful assessments of themselves and others. Quote, differentiating between power struggle and power over, Hodes explained, is the difference between conflict and abuse. So abuse is power over, and conflict is power struggle. As we students discussed and grappled with this insight over the course of the day, my understanding consistently deepened. While obviously significant abuse does take place in life every single day, where one person is being controlled by another or by a group in a manner that the recipient has not contributed to and cannot change, the word abuse has become overused. People may feel angry, frustrated, upset, but this does not mean they are being abused. They could instead be in conflict. Therefore, the fact that one person is suffering does not inherently mean that the other party is to blame. The expectation that we will never feel badly or anxious is an unreasonable expectation. People may not know how to make things better, how to look at their own participation, how to deal with feeling badly about themselves. They may not know how to understand their own actions and are afraid of the implications of these actions on the meaning of their lives. And this may be devastating, tormenting, and painful, but this is not being abused. It does not get resolved by organizing the punishment of another person. People may be part of negative friendships, families, or communities who attack outsiders instead of being self-critical. They may be receiving encouragement to blame and scapegoat others. They may live within groups, relationships, or families that do not tolerate the admission of mistakes and that reinforce supremacy ideologies about each other in order to maintain illusions of righteousness. This pressure, resulting in the action of collectively deflecting blame, does not mean that the person being blamed is abusive. In fact, it says nothing at all about that person except that they are being blamed. Okay. Now, in my 1999 interview with Kate Kendall, who was the founding director of the National Center for Lesbian Rights, she made the observation that has haunted me to this day. We were discussing a trend that was quite prominent at the time, the trend for lesbian biological mothers to use the absence of legal relationship recognition to deny custody to former female partners who had fully participated in raising a child. We were discussing the cruelty to the former partner and to the child, the vindictiveness, the destruction of the community, the endless longing and irresolution that it produces. And I asked Kendall how these women justified these actions, and she said, "It's the cadre of friends." This insight has stayed with me ever since. There's often a cadre of bad friends around a person, encouraging them to do things that are morally wrong, unjustified, and unethical, because endorsing each other's negative actions is built into the group relationship. Kendall recognized how crucial the surrounding community is in determining if a person will insist on false claims of harm or the opposite, face their own participation. And it was interesting because one of the things Hodes told us was that in New York, perpetrators are increasingly the ones to initiate calls to the police. They're increasingly the first to threaten legal action, to send lawyer letters, or threaten or seek restraining orders as part and parcel of their agenda of blame and unilateral control. And interestingly, the National Coalition of Anti-Violence Programs 2014 report on LGBTQI intimate partner abuse noted that in 2013, the police misarrested the survivor as the perpetrator of violence in over half of all queer domestic abuse arrests, misidentifying the perpetrator in same-sex relationships as the one who is butch, of color, not a mother, not a citizen, from another culture, or HIV positive. Now, one of Hodes' many valuable suggestions is to lower the bar for what must happen in a person's life for their suffering to be acknowledged. Quote, "The current paradigm is encouraging all of us to think we are in abusive relationships," Hodes explained, "and if you are not in an abusive relationship, you don't deserve help. Being abused is what makes you eligible, but everyone deserves help when they reach out for it." This is a strikingly humane idea, that the collapse of conflict and abuse is partly the result of a punitive standard in which people are made desperate yet ineligible for compassion. This is a non-cynical reading of a human condition in which people who have suffered in the past or find themselves implicated in situations in which they are afraid to be accountable fear that within their group, acknowledging some responsibility will mean being denied their need to be heard and cared for. So they fall back on the accusation of abuse to guarantee that they will not be questioned in a way that confirms these fears. Especially vulnerable to this are those who experience profound disapproval and criticism early on as children, who are later locked into self-righteous families or supremacy communities with negative bonds. Ultimately, the blurring of conflict and abuse, Hodes says, is, quote, "epidemic," and leads to everyone identifying as a victim, which is paralyzing the search for solutions. I was moved and enlightened by her insight that conflicted people have to prove that they are eligible for compassion. No one can negotiate without being heard. Shunning, therefore, is designed to maintain a unilateral position of unmovable superiority by asserting one's status as abused and the implied consequential right to punish without terms. This concept of having to earn the right to have pain acknowledged is predicated on a need to enforce that one party is righteous and without mistake, while the other is the specter, the residual holder of all evil. If conflicted people were expected and encouraged to produce complex understandings of their relationships, then people could be expected to negotiate instead of having to justify their pain through inflated charges of victimization. Okay, so at this point, I became interested on how did we get here? Like, what is the history of this moment? So here's just a summary. Hi. So in 1958, when I was born in New York City, the laws for women were so bad that if you were raped, your testimony alone was not enough to get you a conviction. You had to have a witness. That's how bad things were when the feminist anti-violence movement emerged in the 1960s. So it was an extreme, extreme situation. Now that movement, when it emerged in the 1960s, it was in the context of many, many movements globally that were liberation movements and had big picture visions about how to transform the way we all live together. And that movement in the 60s was one of those. So when you go back to their original materials, you find that the feminist anti-violence movement in the 1960s felt that male violence against women and children was caused by three things: patriarchy, poverty, and racism. So they saw the answers as structural transformations. Now, so they began these various grassroots services. They started things like hotlines where you could call,
battered women shelters, self-defense classes, all this kind of stuff. And they had, and the demand was very, very high. And in the 70s, there was a program in the U.S. called CETA, where the government would pay salaries of grassroots community-based organizations. But when Ronald Reagan was elected in 1980, which is the date that all of our troubles that we're experiencing now date back to, in the first 3 weeks in office, he eliminated CETA. So these programs all floundered. And then you watch in the 80s how they become taken up by the government. So you see that working in any of these programs, they all became part of government bureaucracies, they had government fundings, they became part of government agencies. In order to work in them, you had to become professionalized. The government got control of these services. Now, this created a crisis in meaning, because the U.S. government is one of the greatest sources of violence in the world. And of course, the police force, which is the force that was going to be enforcing this, well, not only do we know that how violent the police are, but actually, police officer is the American occupation with the highest domestic violence rate of any occupation, including NFL player. So I assure you that with the U.S. government controlling the mandate to end violence, it becomes absurd. And any analysis of patriarchy, poverty, or racism was completely eliminated, because the U.S. government thrives on patriarchy, poverty, and racism. So instead, all of the focus became on punishment. Everything became focused. A whole new level of laws were created, mandatory arrests, all kinds of interventions, the right of the state to intervene in people's homes and in their families. And the entire goal was towards finding out who was the perpetrator and punishing that person, usually through incarceration. So when you look at who that impacts, it almost entirely impacts poor people, because the government has access to poor people's families and can invade their space, and poor people do not have the possibility of fighting systems like automatic arrests and this kind of thing. But when you look at the rates of violence, you can see that for the poorest women in America, the violence rates have not gone down at all, whereas incarceration of men of color around domestic violence issues has gone up tremendously. So we see, but what's interesting is that there was a lot of propaganda in popular culture in the 80s for this, to argue for this system. So for example, I mentioned that's when Law and Order Special Victims Unit started. And if you look at that show, every episode is that there's a perpetrator who's completely evil, there's a victim who's purely innocent, and the answer is the police. So there's a huge amount of cultural propaganda telling people that the appropriate arbiter of their intimate relationships is the police. And we're now at a point today where we're always seeing on the news that someone had trouble with their son, they call the police. The police come, they kill the son. You know, this idea that a community, that you could turn to your community when you have a conflict, and the community can help you negotiate it, gets entirely replaced by the idea that the appropriate thing to do is to call the police, is to call the state. So when I'm looking at this history, I start to realize that there's a pattern here, and the pattern is that when we give up the responsibility to solve our own problems, and we give up the responsibility collectively to help each other negotiate, this enhances the power of the state. So in the book, I give two case studies that I think really prove this to be true. The first is the Israeli war in Gaza in 2014, which I have in a very extensive chapter on. I think it's quite a fascinating story when you start to understand what really happened. But as you all know, the Israeli state is constantly, like Donald Trump, using this language of victimization to describe itself. They're always saying that they're under attack, they're being threatened, they're endangered. Actually, they are the perpetrators, and they have all the power, and they control the situation. So when there is resistance, they call that being under attack. So they're always using this language of abuse tropes. But another really, really interesting example that I explore in a chapter here is what's called HIV criminalization, which is it's a global trend right now. HIV criminalization is enacting laws all over the world, whether it's Taiwan or, I mean, this is like really global, where people who are HIV positive are required by law to disclose their status to sexual partners or be incarcerated, even if they use condoms, even if they're virally suppressed, because we now have drugs that allow people who are HIV positive to be virally suppressed where they don't need condoms. So the various governments are requiring people to disclose. Now, interestingly, one of the worst HIV laws in the world is in Canada. Canada has a good reputation, but believe me, they don't deserve it. It's very deceptive. And so, you know, I started to analyze this. Why is this like neoliberal country with the, you know, that presents itself as so progressive? Why do they have one of the worst HIV laws in the world? And in fact, 150 people have been incarcerated in Canada for not disclosing their status to partners who did not get HIV. So who are these people? So as a good journalist, my first look was, who are these people who are incarcerated? And when I looked into it, half of them are black. Now Canada, there's no black people in Canada, okay? It's 2.5% black. So if half of the people are incarcerated, and then you start to, as you start to take the cases apart, you find out that HIV criminalization was initially an anti-immigrant measure. That's what put it forward. But for our purposes, it serves a really interesting psychological function. Because for 30 years up until HIV criminalization in Canada, HIV negative people were conceptualized as people who have responsibility to protect themselves. Criminalization takes away their responsibility entirely and turns them instead into people who are potentially criminally wronged. And if your main self-identity is that you are potentially criminally wronged, then when something bad happens to you, you go to the state. So the HIV negative person, their sense of responsibility is removed and the power of the state is enhanced. So there's another example. And now that we're on the runaway train of history, as we all are right now, we're seeing all of these paradigms, you know, in play. So that's my presentation. So thank you. So now is the time where I'm happy to hear your disagreements, objections, questions, comments, anything that you have to offer. Yes.
I guess it's not so much a disagreement as something that I find sort of very tricky when I try to apply these ideas,
mm-hmm.
is that I often find that there's like a very narrow middle section between this super intense normalization of abuse that also uses the language of overstating harm, because so much of the abuse that I'm surrounded by or know of pretends to be normal,
mm-hmm.
you know, as in Israel-Palestine, if you just sit in a coffee shop in Tel Aviv and then someone talks about the occupation in an angry way, your sensual surroundings are nice. There, you don't see the occupation. The violence isn't there, but the mere act of you being there is violent in a way. And then on the other hand, what you are describing, in which the abuser is overstating harm in order to scapegoat responsibility. And I guess navigating that in is very hard because the terminologies are the same. You're told that you're exaggerated if you point to it. So I'm wondering if you have any sort of tactics around.
Well, yeah, there's a lot of tactics. Because, you know, if you look at Catherine Hode, so she's running social services, right? So she has to be very, very careful that she understands what's conflict and what's abuse. So I do go into her methodology here. But so if somebody comes in and they're saying, you know, I'm being abused, immediately that's the word that people use. And we all know that in just general, in our friendships, right? People say, my boyfriend's a harasser, he's stalking me, she's abusive. People throw those words around all the time. So the first thing she does is she asks, are you in physical danger right now? That's the very first piece of information that you have to have. And if you can determine that the person does not feel that they are in physical danger right now, then you can go to the next step, which is to ask for the order of events. And because if the focus is not on trying to figure out who to punish, but instead on trying to understand what happened, right, which is a completely, right now we're punishment oriented, but if we're trying to understand what happened and we go through the order of events, very quickly it becomes clear whether it is power over or power struggle. Yes, of course there's gray zones, you know, because we're human beings. But that order of events thing, and I find it even in my own conflicts, you know, like if I try to tell somebody the order of events and then I get to the place where I did the bad thing and I smush it, you know, right there, you know that I'm exaggerating. So that, I think, is a very simple approach, but it's really, really helpful. Yes, Felina.
In an ideal world, your friends are having a conflict, and they have a number of friends who are real friends, who care about both of them, who are mutual friends. They intervene, right? They insist that these people work things out, and a couple or a few of them are there, mediate the conflict. In some way, it's resolved. That's acceptable. That's a compromise, right, to both parties.
I don't think I'm saying any of those things, by the way.
I'm saying that.
Oh, okay.
So, in the non-ideal world that we live in, right, where this is probably a rare situation, one of the more rare situations, you know, what alternatives do we create that do not end up replicating, you know, the same power structure of the police or you know, in which people speaking out, you know, against police actually wish to, you know, fill similar kind of positions or be in similar.
Okay, so you're asking two different things. So let's start with the friends. Okay, your scenario, here's my scenario. People are constantly asking me to hurt other people. I mean, I am constantly being said, why are you talking to her? Why are you going to that party? You shouldn't be working with her. Why are you at that event? Why are you on that thing with that person? I'm always being asked to shun people and exclude them. I mean, I think it's a normal part. I mean, it's a normal part of our experience.
Yeah.
Right now, our definition of what a loyal good friend is that it's the person who says, yeah, she's a real bitch, right? Say like, oh, my girlfriend, she's so abusive. Yeah, she's really horrible. And then, like, if you're really a good friend, you never speak to that girlfriend again and you're mean to her the next time you see her, right? You don't invite her to your party or whatever. That's what we've got going right now. That's the symbol of loyalty. And if you take it to the level of nationalism, it's the same construction, right? You know, if you're a good citizen, you don't speak out against your government or, you know, all this kind of stuff. It's a very resonant structure. But what if we define loyalty as helping people negotiate? So what if, you know, someone says to me, oh, my girlfriend's such a bitch, and I say, you know, how can I help the two of you talk? Or now, if someone says to me, you should have nothing to do with her, I immediately call that person. What do you think is going on? This must be really upsetting for you. How do you understand what's happening? Because we're often told to hurt people who we never ask that person what they think is happening. And if you look at that at the larger geopolitical structure, I mean, look at the way Muslims are being positioned in the United States right now, right? People who have no contact with Muslims are being asked to hate them, to be afraid of them, to harass them on subway platforms. And the most important thing is to ask people, you know, how are you feeling? What's happening to you? How can I help you? It's to break the wall and create the communication. So I think is whether it's in your little clique or it's about nationalism or racism, it's the same methodology. And in terms of resolution, the goal is not the goal is not we're all gonna be friends and solve all our problems. The goal, the goal is something that I call agreement. And I don't mean that we would agree with each other, but that I would be able to say what your version is and you would be able to say what my version is, so that we can agree on what your version is and what my version is. And then we can part. But just so we're not creating negative fantasies about other people that justify escalation and cruelty. Yes, Laura.
It's more kind of a comment, I guess, just thinking about the notion of scapegoating. And I wondered, the work I do is, I do a lot of work in women's prisons, and I'm quite interested in the notion of scapegoating in the sense of the violence that the women have experienced kind of historically, and then their reaction to that violence, then they then become blamed for their violent reaction and then scapegoated and incarcerated. And actually a lot of the women in prison, their story about their own experience is that they have done something wrong, they are a perpetrator. So, and from my position, that seems to be like an internalization of a narrative of abuse that's sort of manifesting itself. There is no, they have no access to agency to sort of name the violence that they've experienced.
I haven't really gone there. I mean, because there's so much written about abuse. There's thousands of books about abuse. This book is about conflict.
Mm.
You know, and all everything that I'm thinking about has to do with conflict and better ways of understanding it and addressing it to avoid escalation.
Mm.
But I don't know that much about abuse itself.
Mm.
And I'm not, I don't really address that.
Mm.
Rex, did you have a hand up? Or, oh, yeah. Okay.
You started off with a kind of identity-based analysis of white working class people.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to know if how you would look at feminist, queer, or radical communities through that same lens.
You know, it's very interesting because that's what everyone wants to talk about. And honestly, I wasn't even thinking about that when I wrote this. The two things I wasn't thinking about were call-out culture and the election. And yet they appeared to become the focus of the way people understood this material because it's so prevalent.
Mm.
So what do I think about that? I mean, there's a lot of issues. Okay, so I mean, on one hand, it fits the paradigm I've been discussing, which is interior anxiety getting externalized. So for those of us who've been excluded from families or have experienced oppression, and I think that as the generations pass, it's actually less. Although there are, of course, lots of young queer people who experience profound oppression, it's not the general normative, most common experience in the way that it was for my generation and older. So that is, there's a legacy change there. And there is a, and so when people tell you that you don't matter and that nothing that you say matters and you don't even deserve to be in your family or the town that you grew up in, then the, and the only people who care what you say are the people in front of you, those are the people who are going to get all your anger because nobody else cares. So, you know, it's very easy to escalate, to blame your, like I have a chapter called calling the police on your partner when it's your father who should have gone to jail. Do you know what I mean? And it's very common for queer people, that sort of construction. But now that we're in a political disaster and a political crisis, this takes on a whole other dimension. And one of my hats is that I run the ACT UP Oral History Project, which is online at actuporalhistory.org if you want to check it out. So over the last 16 years, I've interviewed 187 surviving members of ACT UP New York. And one of the things we find out there is why ACT UP was so successful. You could say it was the last successful social movement in America, honestly. And when you look at how it worked, one of the things that made ACT UP work was that they did not operate by consensus. They had simultaneity of action. So, for example, if I wanted to do an action where I wanted to disrupt Mass at St. Patrick's Cathedral because the Catholic Church was trying to stop condom use in the schools, which in fact I did do, I could do that. And if you didn't want to do it, you would not try to stop me from doing it. You just wouldn't do it. You would go to the Lower East Side and get arrested on purpose doing needle exchange so you could provoke a court case that would make needle exchange legal in New York, which in fact ACT UP did do. So the principle was that it was an emergency and things had to change. So the old left model of the correct line, you know, that there's a, you know, in Leninism, there was something called democratic centralism, was a principle of Leninism, and is that you have the Communist Party and you have the Central Committee, and they decide what the line is going to be, and then everybody has to do it. And that was the, and because the left in America, the old left, in the 30s, was modeled on that, it became a leftist structure, right? That there's a correct line, and there's a correct analysis, and you have to argue with each other to persuade each other towards the correct line. ACT UP politics, which is the politics of emergency, was the opposite of that. There's no correct line, there's no analysis, and there's no need to try to argue with each other to persuade each other to our analyses. where we each have responsibility, because people can only be where they're at, and we each have responsibility to act from where we are. So the idea was that from wherever you are and whatever you're organizing, it should be effective and well organized. Mm-hmm. And so when you look at the history of ACT UP, they're acting in so many different realms at the same time. I mean, there are people doing sex ed in Chinatown in Chinese. There are people starting housing for homeless people with AIDS. I mean, people were just all over the place. And that's what made the paradigm shift happen, because it was on so many fronts. Now, the question of how to organize effectively was also articulated. And interestingly, when you break it down, it actually, at what ACT UP did was actually the very same pattern that Dr. King talks about in Letter from Birmingham Jail. Although ACT UP didn't realize that Dr. King had done the same thing. But the idea is that, number one, you become the expert on your issue so that you're very, very, very self-educated, so that you understand all the options and what the solutions are. Number two, you present a proposal that is reasonable, winnable, and doable. So, for example, saying socialist revolution now, that is not reasonable, winnable, and doable. Okay, it has to be something that if the other side was actually ethical and cared about people, they would agree. And you've done all the work because you're the expert. So you've designed it. So you bring it to the powers that be. And then when they say no, then you do what Dr. King called purification, which is that you prepare for civil disobedience, which ACT UP had trainings and trained marshals and legal observers and people trained in nonviolent civil disobedience. And then you do nonviolent civil disobedience in a manner that uses the media. You talk to the population through the media, not to the media. And in this way, you try to force the powers that be to accept your very reasonable and brilliant solution. So for example, one of the problems that we had early in the AIDS crisis was that there were no treatments. And there were experimental drug trials, but they were all experimenting on the same drug, which was AZT, which was a failed cancer drug. And the people who had the patent for that, Burroughs Wellcome, the pharmaceutical company, only wanted there to be AZT, which did become the highest profit-making pharmaceutical in history. So to try to get them to research other drugs that would have a smaller market was very difficult. So ACT UP designed something called Parallel Track that was an experimental way of getting other drugs studied, presented it to the Food and Drug Administration. They refused to do it. We did an action where we actually shut down the Food and Drug Administration. It was on every television. I mean, people with AIDS shutting down the government, right? And then they accepted Parallel Track. So that was the system. You know, so that everything that you're doing is part of a campaign to get something to happen that will move you forward. So ACT UP, for example, would never do a big demonstration where there are speakers and people stand in the audience. Never, never, never. Because it didn't build to anything. There always was a demand, and the demand was concrete. And then we would do actions to push that demand. But to do actions without a demand is a waste, because you're not building a campaign. So that's how they operated, and I think that we could take advantage of that today. Because there's going to be a lot of different ideas about how to respond on a lot of different levels, and it's a waste of time to critique what other people want to do. If you don't want to do it, don't do it. Like the pantsuit march on Washington, it's not my thing, okay? I'm not going to go. But I'm not going to go spend hours saying that it's bad or other people shouldn't go, because I have other things to do, you know? And that's what we should be doing. So that's one thing that in which this kind of taking people down for using the wrong word or trashing people for nothing, forget that. That's over. That's completely over now. We cannot do that. It's a waste. There has to be, like, you know, if you don't like what someone's doing, they're going to do it. You do your own thing and just be effective in what you do. The other thing is that everything has moved so far to the right that the mainline organizations, which many of us were not involved in directly, like the ACLU and Planned Parenthood, they are the organizations now. That is where the battle lines are being drawn around them. So although it's sad to lose a lot of territory, and I still support organizations like Palestine Legal, and I'm on the advisory board of Jewish Voice for Peace, I'm not abandoning my organizations and Students for Justice in Palestine. But we also have to support those mainline organizations. supporting existing organizations right now is very important. I know that there's an impulse to go out and start new groups, but unless your new group is really amazingly brilliant and has a really amazing thing to do, I would say, you know, you can try to create new coalitions. Like, I noticed that Planned Parenthood took out a full page ad in the paper on the Trans Day of Remembrance. And I was like, okay, great. They understand that we have to work in coalition. And they're reaching out in that way, and that's really important. So, you know, nothing changed. I mean, there's a lot of false propaganda out there about individuals, heroic individuals who save the world, but nothing happens that way. In America, everything that moves forward because of coalition. It's the only way things change here. So you can have new kinds of coalitions, but starting new organizations, unless you really have something big, I don't think this is exactly the moment right now. It could be like in 3 days, because things are moving very fast. And then the other thing is, one second. Oh, yeah. Just I want to remind you that there was an organization in 1992 called the Lesbian Avengers, and it has an interesting history. But they had a few ideas that I think are worth thinking about today. So one idea was no theoretical discussion of any kind. And it's not because they hate theory. Hi, theory. It's not because they hate theory, but it's because if you are doing something that's effective, your theory will emerge in the process of doing. Because if you're organizing an action, you have to make a lot of decisions. And you make those decisions based on your values, and that's your theory. But this is not the time for empty fights about theory that are not about applied actions, because they're polarizing and they're paralyzing. So I think that this is a good time to listen to the Lesbian Avengers. No theoretical discussion of any kind. The other two points that they had that I think are really valid. One is, if you have an idea, you have to do it. You can never ever say someone should. That has to be you. And the third thing is, if you disagree with what someone else is saying, propose a better alternative. Don't just do an empty critique. It's a waste of time. And what's really interesting is I've been in a lot of political movements, and movements where people are desperate and really need change are very effective. And movements where people are like armchair and they don't really need things to change, they get bogged down in bullshit. Seriously. And, you know, where we're at now is just like a complete disaster. And it's going to be a disaster for a really long time, and it's going to be really painful, and there's going to be a lot of suffering. So be calm, but don't waste your energy. You know, be focused. So that's what I would, that would be my answer, a long answer to that question. Yes, Helena.
How do you speak through the media in 2016?
Well, someone much younger than me will know, will be able to figure that out. Because, you know, I mean, in the 80s, you know, the camcorder was invented in the middle of ACT UP. And so ACT UP figured out how to use the camcorder to our benefit, which meant we took the footage, then we would run to the TV station and hand them the footage because they didn't have the footage. Okay, that's a long time ago. But, you know, it's not going to be someone like me who's going to figure out that strategy for our time, right? Because I don't even know what, you know, Snapchat is.
I have a response to that, actually.
Okay.
So, as you may all know about the Oakland fire,
mm-hmm.
with and recent media reporting of what's been happening with the warehouse, so there's been a wide warning. I know someone who was at the fire and very fortunately got out. And there was a huge warning to all queer artists on Facebook saying not to report to the media because it was being utilized by the fire department, the police department, and the city departments of Oakland and San Francisco to shut down warehouses that were not up to code. So due to that warning, because it was taken up by the San Francisco Chronicle, Oakland newspapers, etc., queer artists and media zines, local zines, they were utilizing their own reporting to gather certain news and advocacy around that, and then reporting that to news media and putting those stories in place instead of the narrative that they were generating from their own interviews.
Okay.
Yeah. So there's an example.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you
very much.
Right. I find everything you just said about activism and ACT UP very inspiring, as everything else, and I'm left with this concern that I think you used the word normative to describe resistance.
No, normative conflict.
Normative conflict.
Mm-hmm.
So, resistance, I felt like you said at some point, resistance is a normative reaction to oppression or you didn't.
I don't think so. Yeah.
Because something about
I think I said reasonable.
Reasonable.
Yes.
Because normative.
That's the word.
Yeah, just like made me worried too. That it would undermine the courage, the effectiveness of resistance.
No, if only it was normative, but.
Yeah, because it's. Yeah.
Any other comments? Yes.
I'm just like thinking of like the ACT UP like hypothetical. What if there was someone in New York ACT UP whose view was that immigrants were for the cause of the AIDS crisis and was targeting them? How would that have been dealt with within the organization?
That never happened. Isn't that amazing? I mean, we had a principle of unity, a diverse group of individuals united in anger and dedicated to direct action to end the AIDS crisis. That was the principle of unity of ACT UP. So, yeah, I mean, things happen and people
yeah.
do, you know, divisive things, but if you really, you know, I was saying this the other day, but four people can do a lot. And it's easier for four people to come up with an action that's really going to be effective and then maybe bring other people in or build for it than for 100 people to come up with something. So, like, do not walk into a room of 100 people and say, what are we going to do? That's not going to work. You can come in and, like, when we started the Lesbian Avengers, there were five of us, and we sat down and we started it, and we decided it was going to be, you know, direct action and all these things, and then we called a meeting. We went to Gay Pride and we handed out club cards, which were these little cards that told people when club nights were. And like 100 women came and we said, our organization is going to be like this. It's going to be about that. This is what we're going to do. If you want to do it, stay. And if you don't want to, this is not for you. You know, and that's a really good way to do stuff because and then you're not arguing about your own, you know, your foundational thinking. Right, because you don't want to get caught in that trap where you're trying to accommodate everybody. Like, consensus is not necessary. It's,
mm.
And it keeps you from being effective.
Mm.
Yes?
Something that's really resonated with me in your writing is how you discuss families and how small-scale communities can reinforce supremacist values and ideas. And so, kind of in light of the election, I'm a person who comes from a white working class family that you described that identifies more with race than based on class. And in light of the election, how would you how would you say that we should deal with small scale, like familial conflict in light of like large scale like issues and beliefs? And
it's so hard, right? I mean, the only parallel experience I have is, you know, I take the responsibility to argue with other Jews about Israel, right? And, you know, sometimes you can have a real conversation and sometimes it's impossible. And once you realize it's impossible, you should stop, you know, because it's not going to help you. And if you can't convince your aunt, you know, Edith, a certain thing, it's not going to make a difference because the fact is, you could spend your whole life trying to change one person. But it's more about trying to be effective with people who actually want to learn how. Like, there's a lot of people who want change, they just don't know how to do it. And I think that that's, you know, a little bit more beneficial in terms of your energy, your emotional energy. Okay, anything else on anyone's mind? Any other subjects? Yes, Melina.
What's normative conflict? Is it just another word for normal?
Yeah, it means like, you know, there's always going to be conflict. That's life. It's not the end of the world if you feel uncomfortable. You know, one of the things about entitlement is entitled people feel that they should never be uncomfortable. And in fact, Sarah Ahmed, this is why I learned this from her. You know, she describes this in her book, The Purpose of Happiness, that we have this concept that we have a right to be what?
Promise.
The promise of happiness. Thank you. We have this idea that, you know, we should be able to control every other person so that we're comfortable. That is actually unethical, because then you only can be comfortable at the expense of other people, in fact, by harming other people. So if we embrace being uncomfortable, that being uncomfortable is a healthy place, and it's a normal place, because we're all living together in this world, right?
But because it is the end of the world for Zionists to have their very premise contested by the very existence of Palestine and Palestinians. Yes, it's not something that they should, it's something that we should acknowledge, I think, and give credit to that resistance and say, yes, they are undermining, they're absolutely undermining the state, the foundation of the state and the premise, and good for them. They their missiles don't have enough power to dismantle the IDF, mm-hmm. but their presence has enough power to undermine the very premise of the state. That can't be normative, and it can't be embraced.
Is that something that you examine in your book as like framing it more of a sense of, because I think gaslighting is something
I've written a book previous to this called Israel, Palestine, and the Queer International. So I take on a lot, I mean, the whole book is about that. And yes, Nadia should have a copy of that. But I have, I think, it's about an 80-page chapter here about the Israeli government narrative justifying the war in Gaza and where the lies were and how they were revealed and what was being said in Gaza. I followed every person in Gaza who tweets in English during the Gazan war. So you have what people from Gaza are saying versus the U.S. media, especially the New York Times, which at that time was even more pro-Israel than it is now. The distortions in the media and then the reveals about what actually was happening. I mean, I think it reads a little bit like a novel. Like, I think it's an interesting story in the way that it unfolds, and I believe it's the only place that has been told so far. So I hope that it makes a contribution. That is my hope. So with my hope to make a contribution, thank you all very much, and thank you for being here.